Everything about it. Systems of equations are, well, a system has like multiple working parts, right? A system of equations, multiple equations working together in some way. All right, we'll look at some real world applications so you can see what it might be about that. So I'm gonna give you some ordered pairs like negative 5, negative 1, negative 3, 9, 3, 5, 6, 3. All right, so what I want you to do is figure out, are these guys, these ordered pairs here, are they solutions to these equations? Or kind of think, which equation is each of these a solution to? That make sense? Almost like a matching game, okay? I want you to see if it's a solution. Now, for any of you who might be a little rusty about this, what do I mean by that? See if those are solutions to these equations.
Just stick a point into the x and y.
Put that point in for x and y? Yes.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Take a
wallet.
It's my Smithy, huh? Is that made of toque?
Yes, it is. Right, so yeah, we plug those points in, plug in that x and that y, and see if it's equal, right? It should be equal. If it's not equal, it must not be a solution. So let's refresh our memories and our practice by doing those real quick.
Wait a minute.
We can look across here and say, like, is negative 5, negative 1, is it a solution to this equation?
No.
We tried it out, and we say no. Because what happens, like when you put in those two numbers, what do you get? What equals what?
I got negative.
Oh, okay, negative 17 equals 21. That's what you get.
Right.
And that's not true.
Right.
Okay. What about this side? Is it just yes or no?
Okay.
Well, let's give it a try. Let's see. I mean, it's going to be kind of crazy. Actually,
let's do a little work on the sketch.
How did you get a negative 17?
Well, let's see. 2 times negative 5 for x, right? Plus 3 times negative 1 for y. Negative 10, 2 times negative 5 is negative 10. Yeah, I don't know if this is going to work out. 3 times negative 1 is negative 3, right? So negative 10 minus 3 is negative 13.
I wrote this completely wrong.
Did you put the y, the x
no,
next to the y?
The addition, it's supposed to be addition, not subtraction. I did subtraction, not addition.
Oh. Okay. Well, it still turns out that it doesn't work out, right? That it's not a solution because negative 13 does not equal 21. Okay. Let's try it for this other guy. Negative 5 times negative 5 for x. Plus 2 times negative 1 for y. Does that come out to be negative 5? That's the question. Negative 5 times negative 5? 25.
Minus 2.
Minus 2. Does that come out to be negative 5? No. Okay, so no, because we get 23 is equal to negative 5. So that's not going to work either. 23 equals negative 5. Okay? Get the idea? Testing each point.
Just sticking x and y to the x and y
right
axis.
Exactly. So let's see. Is this point a solution, or is this ordered pair a solution to this equation?
3, 9.
Okay. I'm not sure. Let's try it out. 2 times negative 3 plus 3 times 9. Is that equal to 21? 2 times negative 3 is negative 6. 3 times 9 is 27. Negative 6 plus 27 is 21, just like it ought to be. So, check. Is the solution. Let's see if it works in this other one. Negative 5 times negative 3 plus 2 times 9. Is that equal to negative 5? Negative 5 times negative 3 is 15. 2 times 9 is 18. Is that going to come out to be negative 5? It's not going to come out to be any negative number. Positive plus positive? Definitely not. Okay, figured out that that doesn't work. Okay, so you can get this. Subtract those last two. Try for 3, 5. Try for 6, 3. See if they work in one or both or neither. Okay, what do we decide for 3, 5? Does it work in this equation? Everybody agree it works in this equation?
Yeah.
Okay, sounds like a couple of people are on board here.
I'm on board.
2, 2.
So should we get 2 equals 2? Is that what you're
saying? No.
Oh. 2 times 3 plus 3 times 5, that's 6 plus 15, that's 21, and that's what we're supposed to have, 21. So,
21.
Check.
Check and wait.
Now let's look at this other guy here, 3 and 5. Negative 5 times 3 plus 2 times 5. Negative 15 plus 10, negative 5, and that is what we were supposed to get there. So, also, in this equation, also check it works. Okay, so the other one, does it work in this equation?
No, it does not.
No, it does not. We get 12 plus 9, so we get... plus 9, 2 times 6 is 12, 2 times 3 is 9, 12 plus 9, 21, yeah, it does work. This guy, let's see, negative 30, that's not the prophecy, negative 30 plus 6, no, negative 30 plus 6 is not negative 5, so no, it doesn't work.
So you just like times those numbers by those numbers and then just add them and see what happens?
Pretty much.
Yeah, I mean, that's a short version of saying plug the x into the x and the y into the y and test and see if it works, test and see if it makes the equation true. Okay. So we found quite a few that work in this equation. We found a few that don't work in this equation, one that does. The interesting thing I want to look at is here. 3, 5 works not in just this equation, but also this equation. How likely do you think that is? I mean, do you think there's any other XY combinations that work in both of them? I think there probably is. Okay. How long do you think we'd have to look to find another one? Another one right after that one?
Yeah. The deal is that there's so many numbers that eventually you will find one.
Okay, so there's infinitely many combinations. There's got to be another one out there. Other theories? Or are you mostly just feeling like, yeah, I mean, try for all eternity, eventually you'll find one? Think so?
Yeah.
You don't think so?
Well, if you do that, yeah, then you'll eventually find one.
Okay. Well, it's hard to nail it down for sure when we just have all this stuff written up here and we're just thinking, like, I don't know, there's a lot of numbers. And I would imagine some combination, like maybe it's 7 comma negative 3, right? Plug that in for the x and the y in the first equation and the second equation. Yeah, maybe it works. Or eventually we'll find a combination that works.
Or it's 5 and 10. So it'll be a combination of 5.
5 and 10?
Yeah. Like 5 times 5 is 25.
Okay, so you found, 5, 10, is that what you said?
Here.
5, 10, and you looked over here, right? Yeah, you got negative 5 times 5, negative 25, plus 2 times 10 is 10, or sorry, 2 times 10 is 20. 20 minus 25 is negative 5. So it works in this one. And all we need to do is show that it works in this one. 2 times 5 is 10, right? 3 times 10 is 30. No, that doesn't come out to be 21, but maybe if we keep trying, we'll find one eventually. Well, to help us see whether or not it's feasible for both of these to have another combination that works, ask you what we're doing. We're going to use graphing to visualize what it means to find a solution that works in both, and to find more than one combination of x and y that work in both. To do that, we're going to, like I said just a second ago, we're going to use a graph. So before we start graphing, let's write it in slope-intercept form, right? I don't like slope-intercept form. So why don't you guys write that first one in slope-intercept form, okay? All right, so just seeing the obvious here, y equals mx plus b, right? That's what slope-intercept form is. So you get y by itself, subtract 2x from both sides. 3y equals negative 2x plus 21. Then divide by 3, divide everything by 3. Y equals negative 2/3 x plus 7. So we use the slope-intercept form. 7 is the y-intercept. Negative 2/3 is the slope, right? So we're going to move over 3 and down 2. Down 2 over 3, however you like to do it. All right, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to graph as good a graph as I can possibly muster. Okay? Because in order for this to work, we have to have really good graphs. Like really precisely drawn grid in the first place, points put exactly where they need to be, lines perfectly straight. So from right here, so right there, through this point, as perfectly as I can draw it. I'm going the other way through these two points, so I can draw this just as nicely as I can. Okay. I'm going to get this other guy in slope-intercept form. I'm going to add 5x to both sides, so we get 2y is equal to 5x plus 5, or sorry, not plus 5, minus 5. Minus 5. Add 5x to both sides, you get 5x minus 5 on this side, divide by 2, divide by 2. And we get y is equal to 5 halves x, that's our slope, minus 5 halves, that's our y-intercept. So negative 5 halves, that's negative 2 and a half. Point as accurately as I can humanly put that point at negative 2 and a half. And our slope of 5 halves, 5 over 2, over 2 of 5. We're on the half marks here, we're going up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right there. Okay, best as I can draw those two. Actually, I'm going to grab a. There's a ruler. Straight line of those two points, okay, so we'll draw our line using our ruler. Close that up. I'm kind of over dramatizing the importance of drawing your graphs as accurately as possible. Okay. Let's talk about these lines, as we have talked about lines many times before. What are these lines made up?
A bunch of million dots.
Millions of dots, right? Let's take, like we'll follow the slope, we'll pick a point that's on this screen. Actually, this should have been blue, because that's blue. Maybe I'll just change this to green. So I pick this point right here on the green line, which belongs to the green equation. Okay, this point is at negative 3, comma 9. So what's special about this point and this equation here?
It's a solution.
It's a solution. If I take the negative 3 and plug it in for x and the 9 and plug it in for y, then it should be true. Let's plug in a 9 here for y. 2/3 times negative 3 over 1, 7. So negative, let's say 3 divided by, or negative 3 divided by 3 is negative 1. Negative 2 times negative 1 is positive 2, plus 7, and 9 equals 9. Right? Reminding you of something that you already know, that any point on this line, take that x and y, plug it into this equation, both sides equal. Okay? Likewise, this red line is made up of millions and millions and billions of an infinite number of points. At any point from this red line, we'll do what?
Be a solution.
Be a solution to what? This equation, right? The red equation, however it looks. Whether I plug it in here, here, or here, it's going to come out the same. So any point on the red line is a solution to the red equation. Any point on the green line is a solution to the green equation. All right. What do you see right here?
We're on the same dot.
The same dot is on
both
lines. What point does it look like that is?
3, 5.
Let's take a look back at our work we did here. Look at that, 3, 5 worked in both equations. Right. Makes sense. The lines are just representations of all of the solutions to those equations. There's one that works in both equations. Now looking at these two graphs, let me ask the question again, does it look like there's another XY combination that's gonna work for both of these equations?
No.
It'll happen where the graphs cross, right? Because the graphs are made of points, and where they cross, it really just means they both have the same point. I'm making up a little part of them. But this line goes in, you know, for infinity in both directions, right? Once it goes to this point, it's not coming back. Right? Once it goes to this point in this direction, it's not coming back. Right? It's not going to bend back around and cross this graph again. This part's not going to bend back down and cross this graph anywhere else, right? They're straight lines. Now, other graphs are different. Just a real quick, you know, made up example. If we had two graphs like this one, which is called a parabola, and this one, which is called a line, look at that, they cross once and twice. So they'd have two. Right? Two XY combinations, two points, two ordered pairs that work in both the equations. Whatever those equations are that make these graphs. But with lines, how many times can lines cross each other?
Once. Unless if it's a curved line.
Straight lines. Straight lines are only going to cross each other once or zero times, right? Or there's one other option. That would be zero times. So they either cross zero times or one time. Are they going to cross twice? No. Or maybe let's think of it as they have either 0 points in common, 1 point in common, or how many points could they also have?
All
of the points, right?
They're just the same.
They'd
line.
Be the same line. Okay? So that tells us you're going to have zero solutions, one solution, or infinite solutions. Just by looking at the graphs, you can come up with that. There's either zero solutions, one solution, or infinite solutions. This would be if they're parallel. If they're parallel, they'll never cross each other and they'll never have a solution in common. This would just be they intersect. They don't even have to be perpendicular. They just intersect anywhere. And that would be their solution. Or they have infinite solutions because they're actually the same line. Intercept form, they would be exactly the same. We would both have the exact same equation. So this is our introduction into systems of equations. We can see it visually just up on the graph. Wherever they cross, okay, crossing is really having a point in common, right? And those points, if they're on both lines, then they work in both equations. And you can see that it's unlikely. Well, let's see. If you were to just make up two equations randomly, right? Like maybe these two equations, y equals negative 4/3 x plus 2, and just trying to be as random as I can be as a human being that likes patterns, 5/11 x minus 32. Each of those makes a line, right? When you graph it.
Yes.
How likely do you think it is that those two lines cross? Just randomly choosing a couple of lines, randomly writing their equations, How likely do you think it is that they cross each other?
Maybe not.
50-50? So if you wrote 1,000 equations, only 500 of them would cross each other? Okay.
No. Maybe none would cross each other.
Maybe none? These two cross each other. Right here.
Set.
Yeah, but they weren't completely random.
No. But if I were to like set up a computer to randomly pick slopes and randomly pick y-intercepts, you think it's very likely or not very likely that the two random lines would cross each other?
Not really.
There's definitely a chance. There's a non-zero probability that they will cross each other. What's the only instance when they don't cross each other?
In the parallel.
How likely is it, do you think, that randomly I'll choose some random numbers and come up with two parallel lines? Is that a good chance? Why not? Maybe we'll pick these lines a little bit differently, like pick a couple of broomsticks, okay? And these are like long, straight things, kind of like lines. Just throw down a broomstick, throw down another broomstick, okay? And then, okay, let's say that one broomstick lands like this. What do you think the probability is that the other broomstick will land perfectly parallel to it so that they never cross?
Like exactly?
Exactly, parallel.
Why does it think like that?
They're not parallel.
If you were to draw them infinitely,
they would cross each other at some point. Very likely or not very likely that they're perfectly parallel. Perfectly. Not a million degrees.
0.00001.
So small. How likely is it, do you think, that instead of that happening, one is just like slightly off. If I were to draw them infinitely, they'd cross somewhere over here, right? Or somewhere out there.
Yeah.
Or maybe, you know, one broomstick would just land right on top of the other one, right? Pretty likely two randomly chosen lines are going to cross each other. Because the only way they're not is if they're parallel, which means I have to have
like the board, not straight.
Like the board.
Like from the top to the bottom.
Yes.
You understand?
I understand. That's a yes.
From the top to the bottom.
And that side.
Oh, right. Two sides of the board are perfectly parallel to each other. That'd be really unlikely. And it's actually probably unlikely that the two sides of this board are actually parallel to each other. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like somebody put it together, and you think there's no slight difference between how those joints were attached, now those joints were attached.
They're
a little bit off. Or do you think the machine that made them perfectly perfect?
It would take like a million, thousand, gazillion miles.
Yeah, it might take a gazillion miles to get to their intersection, but you probably would get there. Okay? So, if you chose random lines, they would probably cross each other. It'd be unlikely that you would get exactly the same. What do two parallel lines have in common?
They all have the same slope.
Yes. Very good. They have the exact same slope. And so if we think about it as choosing random numbers, right, to go in these equations, then we'd have to choose this computer that completely randomly chooses numbers. We'd have to pick the exact same number to go here, and the exact same number to go here, to be the same slope. And that is also, from all the infinite number of numbers that it could pick for the slopes, it's very unlikely that it would pick it. So that's a fun little discussion. So the first way, the most basic way that we can find a solution to a system of equations, two equations working together, is to graph them and look for what?
Have a common slope.
Well, if we want to show that they don't cross, but if we do want to find the solution, where will we find the solution on the graph?
The x coordinates.
Where they intersect. Yes. Right? We graph these two. If I had just started from finding the solution to the system of equations, we graph both of the lines, and where they cross, right, is where they share a point. That point would be this one right here. This point is a solution to the red one because it's on the red line, and the green one because it's also on the green line. So, very likely they would find an intersection point unless somebody specifically designed the problem to not, right, but to not cross. Okay. That equation and this equation. Okay. So let's use these two equations. Find the solution to these two equations. Find the solution to this system of equations. Okay. By graphing.
I heard something with situations.
Fine. Okay, so let's talk about a system of equations. Back all the way up to the very beginning here. First of all, let's talk about a system of equations. It's a pretty simple thing. Here's a system of equations. It's just two equations or more. Right? That's it. I mean, there's really nothing else to be said about it. Two or more equations could be considered a system of equations. A solution to the system is a solution that works in this equation and this equation. So here's an example. Here's a system, and because this solution works in both, it's a solution to the system, to both equations at the same time. But rather than randomly just take stabs in the dark as to what the solution might be, our first most basic approach is to graph both equations and find where what happens, where they intersect. Where they cross each other. Because where they cross is where this point is on both lines. So we find where both of the lines cross, both the graphs cross, and that where they cross will be a shared point, a shared solution that works in both of them. So, in case you're not getting the whole picture, just start here, not this one, sorry. Start here. Graph both of these equations. Well, just start there. Graph them both. If you don't know where to go from there, just start there. Okay, so I've started graphing this first line, this orange line. Maybe you treated it like the second one, maybe, but I think it's the first one. So I'm going to do my best to get this very, very straight line. We go through. Points. It's very straight. Well, so we got a y intercept 17, slope of negative 5 halves, right over 2 and down 5. And now this black one, a y intercept of 4 and a slope of 3 fourths. So over 4 and up 3.
Ah, oh, I keep on kidding, we do that.
Remember, that's it's on the y-axis because what I'm doing is plugging 0 for x, right? And that's giving me 17 for y. Alright, there's a...
So, I have to set the intercept just upside down.
Well, we do want to fix that, but that's close. So let me just remind you, if I pick this point, whatever it is, and I plug in the x and the y into this equation, what's going to happen in this black equation when I take the x and the y from here and plug them in there?
So you just went all through the curve.
Yep.
All the one way help.
I don't have that
dot. What's that?
I have
dot. And choose that dot and put it in for this x and y?
You won't get a real solution. Is that a solution?
It'll be a solution.
So
yeah, both sides will be. We don't know what number that we don't know what number it will be exactly, but if I pick this point, right? Which is on the black line, which came from the black equation. But I take the x and the y from that point and plug it in, what happens on both sides? Okay, so I take this point, right? From this graph, the graph of this line, and the graph of this equation. I take that point, that x and that y, whatever they are, I put the x there and the y there, what happens in this equation? Well, okay, let's just try it with a specific point. Like, well, if we follow the slope, we go down, okay, down 3 or 4. Okay, this point should be right on that line. It's at -4, right? -4, 1. So you put in 1 for y, 3/4 times -4, 1, just to make it easy to multiply those fractions together. 4 divides -4, you get -1. 3 times -1 is -3, plus 4.
Well, this equals the y-intercept. I mean, the y-axis.
Oh, this side always equals whatever y is. Yeah. Since y is on this side by itself, then this side should come out to be whatever the y-value is. Another way of saying it is, comes out to be
equal.
Both sides are equal. So I take this point, or this point, this point, this point, doesn't matter which point I choose from that black line, they'll all make the black equation true. They'll all make both sides of that black equation equal to each other. Okay? Similarly, if I choose a point from the orange line, which comes from the orange equation, and I plug that x and the y from that orange line into this orange equation, what'll happen there? It'll become true, both sides will be equal. Let's like choose this one. It looks like it's at 2, 12 equals -5/2 times 2. Choosing this point, 2, 12 plus 17. And 2 divides 2. That's 1. -5 times 1 is -5. And no surprise, -5 plus 17 is 12. Any point on this line makes this equation true. Any point on this line makes this equation true. There's one point in particular, a really special point, because what?
So it's going to be true for both.
True for both. Yeah, there it is right there. It's true for the black one. It's on the black line. It's true for the orange one. It's on the orange line. It's on both of them. Okay. So that solution, right, that point, will be a solution to the orange one because it's on the orange line. It'll be a solution to the black one. Where does it look like that point is?
5, 4? 6. 7 for 4.
Oh, so 4 for x?
Yeah.
7 for y?
Yeah.
4, 7. 4, 7. 4, 7. That's for both. And for the black one, the black one, I can definitely be sure that it is, right? Because y-intercept of 4, go to the right 4 and up 3, but that's going to put me at 4, 7. So definitely true. We already graphed it that way. We can test it in this equation here. 4, 7. 7 for y. And 4 for x. 7 equals 2, divides 4, leaves us with 2, -5 times 2, -10. 7 equals 17 minus 10 is 7. So it's a solution to both because it's on both graphs. It's part of both graphs. Okay. So to use graphing, if I have two equations, I'm going to use graphing to find the solution that works for both of them, or in other words, the solution to the system. When you use graphing, well, I'm going to graph them both. When I graph them both, then what do I look for?
They
intersect. They cross each other. So that point's on both graphs. And any point on a graph points in the equation that the graph makes. So, graph find intersection.
Is that all we're gonna be doing then?
Graphing and intersecting, yeah. But also, I mean, basically, yes. You can apply it to different situations. Now, some of the problem with maybe the graph, these two guys, y equals 2x plus 2, and I'm going to graph y equals 4x plus 6, and maybe tell me what the weaknesses of using graphing are once I get done doing it. All right, so I'm going to start down a y-axis and an x-axis. I'm going to graph this green guy first, so I have a y-intercept of 2 and a slope of 2 over 1, so over 1 and up 2. Graph this line. There we go. Just like that. And this one in black has a y-intercept of 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Slope of 4 over 1, so up 4 over 1. So one, two, three, four, and over 1. So solution gonna be out here somewhere. Here with intersects, right? All right, so what is the solution to the system? Where is the point where they intersect?
Negatives.
Somewhere in the negatives? That seems like pretty for sure. Couldn't get that too long. Let's try maybe 1, 2, maybe -3. Is it -4? Okay. -1, 2, 3, 4. Do you see what I'm trying to show you here? What am I trying to show you?
It's hard to tell.
It's hard to tell. Why is this hard to tell?
Because there's so many little dots that it could be not like on the line, mm-hmm. slightly like off.
Be slightly off, right? So even if it's supposed to be slightly off, how are you going to be able to tell? Okay, if it's supposed to be right on the money, like right on the grid, you still might not be able to tell because what's wrong with my graph and being able to tell where they both intersect? Yeah, the lines aren't straight. Even the y-axis is slanted. You know, the tick marks. I tried to make them uniform, but maybe I didn't make them quite right. There's so many problems with this graph. Okay, and so graphing is not great because, first of all, you need to have high levels of precision. Right? You have like lasers and a perfect grid. And you also have to have amazing eyesight to see exactly where they cross. Okay? And that's only if they intersected at convenient places like -3, -4. Maybe it is -3, -4. Maybe it's -3.5, -4. Maybe it's -3, -4.5. Even worse, maybe it's -3.1 and -4.15. Right? Can't tell just by looking at the graph. Okay? Even if you do have amazing eyesight and laser pencils. Okay? It's just not going to work forever. But it does give us a good idea. These ones will work out pretty nicely as we work through them. They're going to cross like right on the grids. They're going to cross like right at 3, 4, right at 7, 2, whatever. They're going to cross at nice. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to graph and we're going to look at the intersection. Good? So, good time to freshen up those graphing line skills, right? Remember the y-intercept, right? The y-axis on the x-axis. Remember that slope, right? Refresh on that slope. And find the intersection point.